Welcome to the second lecture in the ICJS Confronting Islamophobia speaker series. We are delighted that you are joining us this evening. It is a wonderful privilege to see both old friends and new. Thank you for coming. I am Ben Sachs, the Jewish scholar at the Institute for Islamic, Christian, and Jewish Studies. The ICJS was founded 30 years ago based on the following premise: that we cannot ignore the fear, the ignorance, and contempt that exists between people with different beliefs. Religious difference is a critical challenge for all people. How do we educate our children, our friends, our families, and our congregations to embrace the particular values of our religious communities while simultaneously allowing a space for values that may be at odds with our own? Sadly, as many of you know well, assiduously documented accounts of prejudice, racism, and religious bigotry continue to plague not only our news feeds, but also our day-to-day affairs. Hate incidents, as NPR's Tovia Smith reported yesterday, can show up anywhere. Quote, "But in the wake of the 2016 election, hate has even been showing up a lot at school. Jewish community centers, schools, synagogues, and cemeteries continue to be vandalized, including recently here at B'nai Israel in Baltimore. Muslims and those perceived to be Muslim are being physically attacked and even killed. Mosques are being burned. We are being challenged by violent and dangerous levels of anti-Semitism and Islamophobia in America. So what do we do? How does the ICJS as an organization work to challenge prejudices, fear, and violence? We firmly believe that two ingredients are necessary to building resilient interreligious networks: increased knowledge and real friendships. We can, and indeed we must, work to reduce prejudice in our communities. At the ICJS, our work has never been more urgent. The ICJS remains vigilant in our efforts to combat anti-Semitism. And tonight, we continue the work of confronting Islamophobia in our city and in our state and in our country. Throughout America's history, religious leaders and religious communities have confronted the greatest challenges facing our nation by drawing on the wisdom of diverse religious traditions. The city of Baltimore remains the focal point for a national conversation around questions of justice, race, and community. At this pivotal moment in our city's history, indeed in our nation's history, the ICJS highlights the continued importance of bringing diverse religious perspectives to address civic and social challenges. I conclude by recognizing the ICJS sponsors who made this series possible. Institutional friendships and community partnerships are pivotal to a healthy city and community. It is with deep gratitude that I recognize the ACLU of Maryland, the Howard County Muslim Council, the Maryland Humanities Council, and WYPR. It is now my distinct pleasure to invite my dear friend and colleague, Dr. Hamer Ziad, to the podium, the ICJS Scholar of Islam, to introduce tonight's speaker.
Thank you so much, Ben. Thank you all for being here. It's such a pleasure to see those who were here last time and the new faces in the audience today. It's a great pleasure to introduce Engy Abdelkader. Engy is really uniquely positioned to educate us tonight as a scholar, as a lawyer, and a public intellectual who is deeply attuned to American intellectual, political, and cultural trends. She is a senior fellow and adjunct professor at the Edmund E. Walsh School of Foreign Service at Georgetown University, where she teaches seminars on civil liberties, national security, as well as terrorism and human rights. She is also connected to Georgetown's Bridge Initiative, which is an institute that looks deeply at Islamophobia, the causes, the impact. And she's part of a multi-year research project there at the Al-Walid Center for Muslim-Christian Understanding at Georgetown, where she researches and writes on the intersection of religion, law, and society with a particular focus on Islamophobia. Engy holds a JD from Rutgers University School of Law and an LLM from the UPenn Law School, and she served there as a constitutional law teaching fellow. And her legal scholarship has been published in multiple venues, including the Fordham International Law Journal, the UCLA Journal of Islamic and Near Eastern Law, and the Asian American Law Journal at Berkeley. She is the author of a pivotal report, When Islamophobia Turns Violent, the 2016 US presidential elections that came out of Georgetown, I believe. She is a prolific public speaker on some of the most salient issues of our time: anti-Muslim racism worldwide, analyses of terrorism, religious freedom, civil rights and immigration, the impact of political rhetoric on minority communities, Islamic law and gender, developing Muslim women's leadership, and even laws on the protection of animals. She has spoken at law schools, at college campuses, religious spaces, and community forums, and also works on the international stage at the European Parliament, at the State Department, and at the European Green Party, among other venues. Her popular writing has been featured again in multiple venues, including Time Magazine, CNN, Christian Science Monitor, The Huff Post, where she has a blog, The Washington Post, and again, she writes on some of the most salient cultural and intellectual issues of our day. So it is my distinct pleasure to invite Engy Abdelkader to the stage, and I welcome her. Thank you.
Good evening. I'd like to begin by thanking the various organizations that made this event possible and that brought us together for this conversation, including the Institute for Islamic, Christian, and Jewish Studies, the Howard County Muslim Council, the ACLU of Maryland, Maryland Humanities Council, as well as the WYPR radio station. Also, special thanks to my colleague, Humaira Zayed, who took a leading role in organizing this particular discussion. So I was born and raised in New Jersey. And what I'd like to do tonight is actually begin by sharing an experience I had when I was a senior in high school, and allowing that experience to animate our conversation tonight. So when I was a senior in high school, I was a nerd, very nerdy. And I was also introverted, but outspoken, which makes for a unique combination. I was enrolled in an advanced placement history class. And one day in the spring, very close to graduation, my social studies teacher was speaking about the experience of Muslim women in Iran. And she made a comment, not just about those women, but about women who adhered to the Islamic faith practice more generally. And she said that Muslim women adopt particular religious attire, the hijab, because they're indoctrinated into doing so, and that it is not a voluntary choice. She wasn't speaking just of the experience of women in Iran, but more broadly about all Muslim women. Unlike the way that I appear before you today, at that time, I did not actually observe hijab. It would be many, many years before I would choose to do so. But unbeknownst to my teacher and to most of my classmates at that time, I had relatives and family friends who did adopt religious attire. Specifically, my mother wore hijab. And through that experience, I saw her personal choice, free of any coercion or pressure from family members or members of our community to do so. And for whatever reason, I felt compelled to share that perspective. And so there in my high school history class, put up my hand, and when my teacher called on me, I explained to her that I was a Muslim and that my mother wore hijab, and that it's not true that all Muslim women are compelled to do so, but rather many, like my mother, do so voluntarily. The class fell in silence. So my classmate, Ron, who sat right next to me, and who I should note was a jock in high school parlance, and very popular, something I was not in high school, rose his hand, and he was called on. And when he was called on, he intervened and said that often we fear what we do not know, and that if we give each other a chance and get to know one another, we won't be so scared of these things. Now, it's interesting that day in high school, Ron chose to speak up and in a way support me when no one else in class did. I had friends in that class and they chose to remain silent. There were other minorities in that class, but they chose to remain silent. Ron was a white Christian male, and he spoke up. The reason why this is significant is for a number of different points that I'd like to highlight tonight. The first being that this conversation and experience occurred prior to the events of the September 11th terrorist attacks. That is to say that myths, misconceptions, and stereotypes about Muslims and Islam did not begin on September 11th, 2001, despite the association we often make with that tragic day. In fact, according to a number of scholars, including Gabrielle Greenberg and Peter Gottschalk, who authored the book Islamophobia, Making Muslims the Enemy, Todd Green, who authored the book Fear of Islam, as well as Deepa Kumar, who authored the book Islamophobia and the Politics of Empire. These scholars argue that Islamophobia, prejudice and discrimination against Muslims and surrounding their faith tradition, may be as old as the religion itself. They'll point out to specific times when interactions historically have shaped perceptions of the quote-unquote other. These may include the Crusades, for example, when Muslims were referred to as a, quote, vile race, pagans, infidels, and barbarians. Or during the Reconquista, a series of wars between the Christian kingdom and Muslim Moors for control of the Iberian Peninsula. And while many of us associate the year 1492 with when Christopher Columbus sailed the ocean blue, in history it's also written down as the year that Muslims of Spain were given a stark choice. You either convert, you leave, or you will die. Islamophobia was institutionalized during the period of European imperialism and hegemony. The problem wasn't just that the Europeans physically dominated the indigenous people in Muslim lands. It's that they conquered them intellectually as well. They dictated the terms that Muslims should view the world, but perhaps more importantly, the way that they should view themselves. And today, we continue to grapple, not just overseas, but right here at home, with the intellectual legacy of colonialism. We see Muslims the way that we're told to see Muslims, by those in positions of power and authority. Very much like my social studies teacher in that advanced placement history class in New Jersey. And that's where I'd like to speak about countering violent extremism. Because in my view, countering violent extremism and its disproportionate focus and scrutiny on the Muslim American community in our country is in fact a manifestation of this intellectual legacy that I've referred to. By way of background, countering violent extremism came out of a 2007 implementation plan for empowering local partners to prevent violent extremism in the United States. According to the US Department of Homeland Security, there were three broad objectives. The first was to actually understand violent extremism, essentially assessing the threat in our country. The second objective was to support local communities, strengthening local partners on the ground so that they could prevent and identify trends in radicalization. The third objective was to support local law enforcement officials to enable them to disrupt and deter recruitment efforts. That doesn't sound so bad. I think most Americans would agree that we all want to be safe, and we're willing to do our part to make that happen. And that's true of the overwhelming majority of Americans who are Muslim as well. Our priorities tend to be good education, good health care, good jobs. Most Muslim Americans just want to work hard and get ahead. That's what this research shows. So what's the problem with the Countering Violent Extremism program, particularly as it flourished initially during Obama's administration? Essentially, while countering violent extremism sounds innocuous, because theoretically it encompasses all different types of violent extremism, not any one particular ideology, not any one particular group, but all of them. But in practice, it focused almost exclusively on the Muslim American community. As a result, that community, together with civil liberties experts, voiced a number of key concerns. Number one, the fact that it focused disproportionately on a minority religious community stigmatized that community. If the general public understands from its elected officials and law enforcement agencies that a particular group of people in their midst represents a threat to their safety and security, they will act on that. They may not want that community to build houses of worship in their neighborhood because they see the mosque as a potential bastion for radicalization. They may not want their children to play with children who are Muslim in school or afterwards because they're seen as an other, as being different. They may not want to employ individuals who are Muslims out of a misplaced sense of patriotism and loyalty. So there is stigma. Number two, countering violent extremism programs relies on flawed models of predicting extremism. What does this mean? Today, most law enforcement agents will concede that there is no magical formula, no magical checklist, no magical criteria to predict when an individual will radicalize and embrace a violent ideology. For example, a research study conducted at Georgetown University into lone wolf terrorist actors found that the majority were actually white. They also found that about 40% experienced unemployment. They also found that the majority suffered some kind of psychological disturbance, and that mental break was what made them vulnerable to extremist recruitment efforts. They wanted a sense of belonging. They wanted to fit in somewhere. Not what we would expect in terms of our lay understanding of who terrorists are and where the threat emanates from. In fact, oftentimes when we think about countering violent extremism and how we might predict and avert violent behavior, we conflate religious practices and beliefs with potential criminality. This has in fact been in the case with some local law enforcement agencies, such as the NYPD, for example. A number of years ago, in a series of reports by the Associated Press, it was discovered that there was a particular unit called the Demographics Unit that engaged in surveillance of Muslim Americans all along the Northeast Corridor. The reason why this is problematic isn't because the NYPD was involved in trying to avert any kind of violence occurring against innocent civilians in our midst. The reason it was problematic is because they were surveilling Americans for no other reason than who they were and what they believed, and not based on any kind of evidence or indicia of wrongdoing, not based on any kind of individualized criminal suspicion. So essentially, the misplaced understanding was that if someone decides to start growing a beard, stop going to the bar or clubs, and no longer wants to have a girlfriend, then he must be at risk of becoming a violent extremist. If a young Muslim woman starts to embrace hijab, prays 5 times a day, and engages in other constitutionally protected activities, she may pose a risk and embrace violent extremism. In fact, what the AP revealed is that the notes that individual NYPD officers took included observations about such constitutionally protected activities, such as praying during a trip to go whitewater rafting, or individuals who hung out at a hookah bar, or who happened to purchase food at a halal butcher shop. That was their crime. That's why they were under surveillance and suspicion of violent extremism. The third key concern that civil liberty advocates, as well as Muslim American community organizations, communicate is the fact that funding from the federal government for local community organizations to participate in CVE programs has two effects. One, it may inadvertently establish a state-sanctioned version of religion, because some of these organizations actually engage in interpretations of religious doctrine, particularly of various verses that are often taken out of context and used and manipulated by violent extremist recruiters and terrorists. Now, when this is done organically, there's not as much concern. There is a marketplace of ideas, people are exposed to these ideas, and they get to choose which religious precepts they want to subscribe to. But when the federal government is actually funding particular organizations who are actively engaged in the interpretation of religious texts, it gives the impression that the government is advocating a certain interpretation of religion. And that becomes problematic within the community. And in fact, the very individuals who may be susceptible to such interpretations and recruitment efforts are more likely to stay away and be suspicious of those very organizations with ties to the federal government. Another related concern to the private, to the federal funding of these organizations for CVE efforts is the fact that some of these organizations are actually engaged in identifying individuals who are susceptible to radicalization or who they believe have become radicalized. That can be very subjective. And the concern is that essentially there is an advocacy by government officials for Muslims to spy on one another. This creates distrust and suspicion. And as you might well imagine, individuals who are in fact likely to radicalize or in the process of radicalization will be sure to stay away from those individuals who are receiving such funding. They'll be likely to keep their thoughts and their opinions to themselves and not reveal it because they are aware of the environment that's been created. In fact, research shows, contrary to popular perception, that most individuals today are in fact radicalizing in the privacy of their own homes on the internet. Not in the mosque, not in community centers, not among friends and family, but all alone on the internet. Another concern or observation shared by Muslim Americans in response to the Countering Violent Extremism program is that violent extremism doesn't represent the most formidable threat or concern to the minority community today. In fact, what they see as representing the most urgent threat is Islamophobia, anti-Muslim prejudice and discrimination. So let me take a moment to explain why that might be. According to the US Department of Justice, 40% of all of their civil rights investigations into violations of religious land use laws, these are the laws that our country has to prevent local zoning officials and other government officials from discriminating against religious communities who want to build houses of worship or other religious institutions. They can't discriminate against people on account of who they are or what they believe. So 40% of the cases that the Department of Justice is currently investigating into violations of religious land use laws come from the Muslim American community. According to the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, the federal agency tasked with enforcing our civil rights laws in the workplace, 40% of all religious discrimination cases in the workplace come from the American Muslim community. According to the FBI, there is a 67% increase in anti-Muslim hate crimes. And that is commonly understood as being widely underreported. It's significant because it represents an upwards trend in violence directed at individuals who are Muslims, their institutions, or those who are perceived to be. Now, to help put this in proper perspective, it's important for me to tell you that Muslim Americans only make up 1 to 2% of our entire population. So we have 1 to 2% of the entire population responsible for 40% of all religious land use discrimination cases open and being investigated by the Department of Justice today. We have 1 to 2% of our entire population responsible for 40% of employment discrimination cases today. 1 to 2% of our population has experienced a 67% increase in hate crimes against individuals and institutions. So when Muslim Americans are asked about their priorities in terms of their safety, their concern isn't with terrorism. Their concern is from private actors, and organizations and groups that threaten to harm them because of their constitutionally protected faith beliefs and practices. So maybe you're asking yourselves, so how does this relate to this intellectual legacy of colonialism? So let me tell you why I think that. According to the FBI, their data from 1980 to 2005 showed that Muslims were responsible for 6% of all terrorist attacks in the United States. Let me repeat that. According to the FBI, from 1980 to 2005, Muslims, individuals identifying as Muslims, were responsible for 6% of all terrorist attacks on US soil. According to academic research, from 2011 to 2015, individuals identifying as Muslims accounted for 12% of all terrorist attacks in the United States. Let me repeat that. According to academic research, from 2011 to 2015, Muslims accounted for 12% of all terrorist attacks on US soil. According to the University of Maryland and Duke University research, there is a greater threat to our national security from right-wing extremist groups. And that's according to surveys that they conducted with law enforcement officials. And this was true even after ISIS enhanced their recruitment efforts. Law enforcement officials throughout the country reported that they feared national security risk from right-wing extremists. In fact, according to Duke University, their most recent report issued this year, January 2017, from the Triangle Center on Muslim Americans and violent extremism, not only showed that violent extremism was down 40% in that minority faith community, but it also showed that more Americans died from mass shootings last year in 2016 than they have in the past 15 years by Muslims and terrorist attacks. According to Duke University, more Americans died last year in mass shootings than they have in the past 15 years by Muslim Americans and terrorist attacks. According to Duke University, more Americans died in mass shootings last year than they have by Muslim Americans and terrorist attacks for the past 15 years cumulatively. And yet, according to research from Chapman University into American fears, Americans are more afraid of terrorism than anything else except for government corruption. I agree with about government corruption, but. So the research tells us that there's an ignored threat from right-wing extremists and white supremacist groups. And yet, the research also tells us that we're fearful of terrorism, and that we associate terrorism most closely with Muslim Americans. So we see Muslims the way that we're told to see them, even if the data tells us that that's not the fact. So in that history class, when I was a senior in high school, Ron said that we fear what we do not know. And the fact is, even 15 years after the events of September 11th, we really still don't know Muslims or Islam. And that may help account for our fear of both those things, of the religion and of its community of believers. One of the facts that helps obscure our ability to know Muslims is their status as a minority faith community. The fact that they are only 1-2% of our population means that the probability of encountering a Muslim as a coworker, a classmate, or even a neighbor is pretty slim. In fact, the most influential information source about Americans who are Muslims today proves to be the news media. And research shows that 9 out of 10 stories about Muslims and Islam are in a context of violence. It's either war or terrorism. So 9 out of 10 times when we're hearing about Muslims, it's in the context of war or terrorism. Even though the research shows that 99% of the community has not been involved in violent extremism. Those negative portrayals reinforce the stereotypes, misconceptions, and myths that we have about the faith tradition and about those who adhere to it. The challenge, though, isn't just the way the news media covers Muslims and Islam. It's also the way they cover terrorism. Because according to the data that I just shared with you, if Muslims are not responsible for the number of terrorist attacks or events or plots that are occurring on US soil, where are all the stories about the groups who are? In fact, research shows that more likely than not, when we hear about terrorism on TV, it's when a Muslim is implicated in that criminality. There are, of course, other factors that contribute to our myths and misconceptions and Islamophobia more generally, not just the news media. For example, the way that Muslims are portrayed in popular culture, such as movies like the blockbuster film American Sniper, or popular shows like Homeland. There are also a network of experts who get paid and are involved in a multi-million dollar industry to perpetuate fear. If you're interested in learning more about these individuals and their efforts to foment hate against a minority faith community, I encourage you to read the report Fear, Inc. by the Center for American Progress, which is available online, or the report by the Council on American Islamic Relations, Manufacturing Fear, which documents the continued efforts of these individuals and their institutions and reveals how millions of dollars are poured in to fomenting fear and prejudice against the minority faith community. In addition, there are laws and policies, such as the CVE program, that help perpetuate the fear and myths and misconceptions about Muslims. More recently, we've seen a number of executive orders from the current administration that represent nothing short of institutionalized discrimination. They're directed at individuals from certain countries, Muslim-majority countries, with the pretextual rationale that we're protecting national security, despite the fact that even intelligence from the US Department of Homeland Security shows that there is no connection between country of citizenship and likelihood of committing a terrorist attack. What policies such as those do, though, is signal to the broader American public that Muslims are unwelcome and that they are suspect. They should not be trusted because they are inherently violent. There's also the role of our military interventions. In fact, since 1980, we have invaded, bombed, or occupied at least 14 Muslim-majority countries. And when you're fighting an enemy overseas, sometimes it's really hard to differentiate the quote-unquote bad Muslims over there from the quote-unquote good ones over here. It can be easy to sort of just generalize and lump them all together and view them as an enemy, not to be trusted. So what can we do in the face of rising Islamophobia? I think you should do what Ron did, which is speak up. Show solidarity when you see something wrong happening, whether that's in your neighborhood, whether that's in the school, whether that's at work, or just in society in general. Speak up. Model the change that you want to see in the world. Recently, a local imam shared a saying which resonated with me. It said, if you look for a seashell, you will find a seashell. And if you look inside, you will find a pearl. And I'm sure that saying is subject to many different interpretations, but what it meant to me is that you will find what you are looking for. And that means if you pick up the Quran looking for violence, you will find violence, much in the same way that you will find violence in other scriptures across faith traditions. And if you meet a Muslim looking for negative traits, you will find it. But if you realize that each of us has both conscious and implicit biases that we're probably not even aware of, and if you're willing to actively overcome them, it may be that the pearl you discover is the friendship with someone who may not be exactly like you. Thank you.
Of the organizations that can either combat, national organizations, local organizations that either combat the Islamophobia or promote, I guess the proper word would be Islamophilia, what are the most effective, most cost-effective ones that one could look toward supporting?
That's a great question. I guess the three that come to mind is the ACLU, as well as the Council on American Islamic Relations, and Muslim Advocates, and the Muslim Public Affairs Council as well. I think they all have a particular niche area, so you should look them up, and I think you can support them, whether it's financially or through volunteer efforts, or just subscribing to their lists and following up on the action items that they send. Thank you.
Could you say a little more about those groups that ferment hate and fear? You mentioned it a little bit, but I did wonder if you could say a little more.
Sure.
What are the, where can we identify those groups?
They have been identified in the reports that I mentioned by the Center for American Progress, as well as the Council for American Islamic Relations. They include organizations such as the Center for Security Policy, which is headed by an individual by the name of Frank Gaffney, who unfortunately has connections to key surrogates within the current administration. His influence and his organization's influence on some of the policy initiatives that are coming out of this administration are well documented by the press and scholars and other advocates. Another organization is ACT for America, which is headed by a woman called Bridget Gabriel, who just recently met with members of the White House and tweeted about it, which caused a firestorm of controversy, particularly among individuals associated, again, with advocacy groups and think tanks that work on these issues. So there are a number of individuals who specialize in this area. Those are two key organizations with direct ties to influential, high-level individuals within the current administration, and in fact are helping to influence some of the institutionalized discriminatory efforts that we're seeing.
Yes, I have. My question is an observation that I have. Whenever there is a crime committed by a Muslim American, immediately, right off the bat, he or she is termed a terrorist. Whereas if a white American commits a crime, which is a terrorist act, they are seldom labeled a terrorist. I'll give you an example of Dylann Roof. He murdered 9 people in cold blood, and he was not even handcuffed, and in fact, he was given a burger at Burger King before he was taken into custody. Why do you think that occurs?
So it's interesting because your observation is actually confirmed through academic research from various institutions that there is more of a likelihood to associate and label criminality by individuals who self-identify as Muslims as acts of terrorism versus those who are not in fact Muslim. To take that a step further, there's also more of a likelihood to cover acts of then terrorism committed by Muslims in the news media when they are in fact associated with Islam, as opposed to criminality that is similarly terroristic in nature but committed by individuals who are not necessarily Muslim. So I think that both those facts, it's not just the labeling that's problematic, it's also how it's reported in the news, because oftentimes that influences our understanding and perception of the world and the reality around us, right? So why is that? I think it's both conscious and unconscious biases that influence that process, and I think the way to overcome it is through conversations such as this, as well as advocacy efforts with policymakers and law enforcement officials that help influence this process, as well as educational initiatives with members of the news media. I think members of the news media are humans just like us, and they may not be aware of the biases that are influencing their reporting. And so I know that even at Georgetown, for example, we held a program for journalists who specialize in matters of religion, and at the Newseum Institute in Washington, D.C. last year. And it was, in my view, I think it was highly successful because the audience was largely journalists, and afterwards they seemed really genuinely interested in how they could engage, and not just in terms of covering terrorism, but how they could actually cover and write stories about Muslims that were not exclusively in the context of violence or through the lens of security, right? I mean, the overwhelming majority of Muslims in America are just like you and me. You know, they're your taxi cab drivers, your engineers, your nurses, your doctors, your entrepreneurs, your the hosts on radio stations, comedians. I mean, you name it, and that's an American Muslim is doing that job and serves that role. But we seldom hear about them, except for when someone is choosing to engage in an act of criminality. And then for some reason, we impute that criminality. We impute those extreme violent ideologies to the entire group. And in the United States, we don't believe in holding entire groups responsible for the acts of an individual. We believe in holding an individual responsible for his or her act and in accordance to the rule of law, right? So I think it's really about education. Education is key among diverse constituencies.
Speaking of holding individuals responsible for their own actions, it's wonderful that there are organizations around, such as the sponsors and others, to do these things, and we can join, and we can be activists, etc. But in addition, I would hate for people to leave thinking, unless they join an organization or do something on a very large scale, that that's the only thing that can be done. I took a peace ambassador training course through the shiftnetwork.com last spring, became a certified peace ambassador, and we, part of the course, a three-month course, there were over 200 students from over 20 countries, time zones, etc. And we all came together in peace, and we had to develop a peace project. And I didn't even realize that that's what I was doing when I was doing this, but basically what I started doing was inviting people to my home for Friday night Shabbat dinner to share my Judaism and some of my practices and the things that I'm proud of in my culture, who are different from me, Muslim, Black, Latino, etc. Now, I'm not like just walking out on the streets and saying, hey, you look different than me, come on by. But the point is, I realized after I was doing this a while that my belief is that if we but break bread together, and whether it's one-on-one, one-on-ten, whatever, you know, we all put our pants on one leg at a time. We all brush our teeth. We all brush our hair. And just like you said about the roles and jobs that Muslim Americans have is no different than Greek Americans, Jewish Americans, Catholic Americans, etc. And so I came to call it the Breaking Bread Project. I want it to go viral, guys. Do it. Do it. You're all invited to my house tomorrow night. Seriously.
Would you like us to put your address on our website? We had up here.
So thanks for the talk. So I guess my point is, I know you mentioned that, I guess, Muslims are in a stark minority, 1-2%, so you're saying that a lot of people aren't necessarily working with folks, and yet in reality, other than folks who are wearing hijab, it may be that people are working with Muslims and they're not aware of it because people aren't wearing signs. So other than being African-American, where it's obvious, not so obvious if you're to be Jewish. So within the Muslim community, realizing that this is sort of like a double-edged sword, is there a view, are you aware amongst the community, like you're saying, you were outspoken, what's the view about being more, realizing it could be dangerous, but what's the view about being, say, more outspoken to say, hey, like you're saying, you spoke out, for people to speak out more within the community so that others would actually realize that engineer that you're working next to is Muslim, right? The doctor that you're working with is. I'm just saying, is there consensus or some small population? What's the view within the community as far as becoming more public as this minority religion?
I mean, so I think that's a really intriguing question, just because, you know, in the past 15 years, and particularly more so now with the heightened Islamophobia, there's now a sense of urgency among Muslim Americans that there is a need to educate and to engage with members of the larger society. And the way that it's manifesting is diverse from, you know, individuals in Boston, Massachusetts. There's a woman and her husband who set up a stand in Boston, Massachusetts and said, I'm a Muslim, come speak to me with a box of donuts, right? Seriously, Google it. I mean, to me, and you know, there's a comedian in New York by the name of Dean Obadella, who he also went around with fellow comedians to different locations throughout the United States and, you know, said, meet a Muslim. So there's a big stand in various areas, the Midwest, the South, and with a big stand and three diverse looking, you know, Muslim Americans with a big sign saying meet a Muslims with, you know, drinks and food available as enticement to lure people in to talk to them. You know, so on the one hand, it is kind of humorous, right, that's happening. On the other hand, you can't help but also feel that it's somewhat tragic, as well. That, you know, regular everyday Americans feel compelled to set up things akin to a lemonade stand to just give people an opportunity to meet someone other than the negative portrayals that we meet every day on our screens, right? So is there, you know, an effort or a movement within the American Muslim community? Absolutely. But it can't be a one-way deal. There also needs to be an understanding that this is a minority community and that they're Americans just like you and me. And I don't think they have any special responsibility to have to go out and prove themselves, much in the same way that other members of our society don't need to set up lemonade stands and invite people to get to know who they are either, right? We need to understand that there are some, you know, biased, discriminatory notions that we find ourselves entrenched in as Americans. Just because one person bombs an abortion clinic and says that they do so in the name of Christianity does not taint the religion of Christianity. It also does not give me justification to impute his criminal intentions and interpretations of religious doctrine to all Christians around the country. And to do so to Muslims is unfair and discriminatory. And so we need to check ourselves as Americans and say, there's something wrong about the way that we see other Americans who happen to be Muslims, let alone the fact that we're inflicting violence upon them in the street, the fact that we're discriminating against them at work, the fact that we're bullying them in school, and we're not allowing them to build their mosques. This is who we are as America. These are the values we were founded on, not to mention the laws that govern us as a country.
I saw some other hands.
First, I just wanted to say thank you for everything that you said and the insight on the CVE program. And I'm one of the ambiguously Muslims in the community. I don't look it, but I am. And I guess what my question is following up with that is, as a Muslim, we're encouraged to speak up, but what I find that not only myself, but some other friends of the families, they struggle with, why do we have to keep on speaking up? Why is it almost we feel compelled to respond to every act of terrorism to assure that this isn't Islamic? When do we draw the line to say it's not our responsibility to apologize for something that had nothing to do with us and our beliefs?
Thank you. So just, you know, by way of background, what she's referring to is a current debate or discourse that's occurring within the American Muslim community surrounding condemnations of terrorist attacks, right? So over the past 15 years, oftentimes you'll hear in news media by pundits and politicians alike sometimes, where are the moderate Muslims? Why aren't they speaking up? Why aren't they condemning terrorism? The fact is that they have been continually. And you only need to Google it to see all almost 800 condemnations over the past 15 years by diverse religious scholars and organizations and various entities. What's happened, though, is that notwithstanding all of these condemnations over the course of time, the question persists. And in fact, polling shows that the majority of Americans believe, mistakenly, that Muslims are not doing enough to confront violent extremism in their communities, right? The reason I say mistakenly is because research from the Triangle Center at Duke University shows that Muslim Americans are in fact the number one source of tips for law enforcement officials when it comes to foiling terrorist plots in our midst. They're the group that provides tips the most to law enforcement officials. Research from Duke University also shows that Muslims, and that research that I'm going to cite to right now was actually funded by the US Department of Justice, a federal government agency, but it shows that Muslim Americans are actively engaged in self-policing, community building, as well as engaging with political institutions and the youth to prevent violent extremism. So they're engaged in these activities organically, not because they're receiving any money to do so, but because they're doing it in accordance with their own convictions and principles and values, right? But clearly there is a disconnect between the perception in American society at large and what's actually happening in the Muslim American community as documented in these various research. So what's happened now in the past year or so is that increasingly there's rumblings happening in the Muslim American communities, particularly among the, I would say, more youthful segment in terms of why do we need to condemn every act of terrorism? No other group in the United States is expected to publicly condemn an act of criminality in our midst. And yet we have this expectation, this demand almost, that this particular religious minority group publicly condemn each and every act of terrorism. So on one side of the spectrum, there's this contingency that says that's absolutely racist, and I refuse to condemn an act that I was not involved in, that I have no responsibility for, and shame on you for expecting me to do so. Another side of the spectrum within the Muslim American community is the viewpoint, totally agree with you, but given the current reality that we find ourselves in, given the fact that we are a minority community, we have to speak up. Because if we remain silent, there will be a nefarious voice that will fill that void and paint us in a way that does not serve our interests. So we need to fill the void. And that's where the Muslim American community is right now. It's that debate.
I'd like to thank you for what you've said, and I agree with everything I've heard, but I want to raise one thing that I think everybody in this room knows, but we haven't talked about it overtly. This wave of Islamophobia and anti-immigrant hysteria that we're hearing over this last year is overtly a tool as part of a movement to gain political power. And in that regard, I think the response has to be not only individual relationships and fellowship, which I think is important, but political action on the part of faith communities and others who believe that they have to stand up, not just for the Islamic community, but for the fundamental values on which this country was founded. You have local governments that are trying to do this. It happened in Baltimore County this morning. Baltimore City has done so. There's an attempt to pass a law in the state of Maryland. There are various groups that have spoken out. There's a greater need, I think, for people to stand up and say, we are telling our elected representatives this will not stand. This is not about just the Islamic community, even though the Islamic community is suffering injustice in this regard. That people really need to say, we are political actors, we need to band together, we need to do something to convince people that this is just not right.
Yeah, thank you for that. I agree. I think one of the trends that I'm seeing in recent months, there's been the passage of various resolutions against Islamophobia by local government and together with community advocates. It's happening in diverse locations throughout the country. So I think that's a positive development, and I agree. I mean, it's not about the Muslim American community, it's about the U.S. Constitution. Yes.
Okay. I am a Japanese American who was involved in the evacuation of the Japanese Americans in 1943 or 4, and I'm very proud to tell you that the third generation of Japanese Americans, which would be our children, are very, very active in California trying to keep the Muslims from being targeted, and they do not want the internment of all of you to happen again. And I think you should know that you have a big support among the Japanese Americans.
Thank you.
Dr. Abdelkader, I'd like to thank you for your data and your clarity, because there's so much fog that, having someone like yourself who can like cut through it and document it, lay it out, it's phenomenally appreciated. So I just want to say that first of all. And my question is there hope? It's like, I mean, so I'm Muslim and I'm African American, so I got the double whammy, right? And it sometimes look, London just elected a Muslim mayor, all right? My Canadian friends are getting ready for Muslim Fest, right? Muslim Fest, right? And then here in the US, it's like, don't go outside, you'll get deported. It's like, it's insane. I went, okay, so in all the data that you see, and all of the things that people you come into contact with, is there some glimmer of hope? Is there some trend someplace that says, well, actually, over here, here's what works?
You know, so it's interesting. Is there hope? This is a really dark time, I think, in terms of religious freedom for the United States and some of the trends that we're seeing. When I hear your question, I immediately view it through the lens of my religion and my tradition as a Muslim. There is a saying by the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who Muslims believe was the final prophet and messenger sent by God in a long line of messengers and prophets beginning with Adam. And the saying has the effect of teaching that even if you know that tomorrow the world will end, plant the seed that you have in your hands today. And I think we have to draw upon that even when things seem very dark. That you just keep going with hope because you don't know, right? And everything that we do and that we say matters.
Thank you very much. Even at this time, which we look at and think that this is very dark, there are very positive signs that they're right in front of us. Muslims raising funds to help repair damage to Jewish cemeteries. Muslims and Jews working together to fix and repair damaged synagogues, mosques, and so forth. These are all positive. That's the beginning of a grassroots process. We don't need a lot of organizations at this point. We need the time to get to know each other, talk to each other, interact with each other, and just forget about the haters. Thank you.
I'm here tonight because no one in my church would come here. I'm Episcopalian. They're very afraid of you. You need to know that I have a family member who is in Florida in a 3,000-member church. They're terrified of you. There's a conspiracy that my family member told me, whispered to me, you are all planning to kill us, that the Quran teaches you all secretly to kill us, that I should know this. This is why I'm here tonight. I'm by myself. I'm trying. But what it reminds me of a lot is the uprising of the slaves in the South, the fear the white man had. It is the same fear right now that what I'm seeing, especially the religious right, they are so afraid of you, and I hear it. And so you should know, I guess you do. They are telling me in a conspiratorial tone, don't I know you're trying to kill me? So me being here tonight, believe me, I'm getting beaten up for this. But I want you all to know, if you get tired, don't get tired. Because I don't know what Islam believes in. I have no idea, and I'm going to figure out a way to find out more. But I'm battling this by myself, and I'm as WASP as they come. And I'm doing the best I can, but you need to know we're out there pushing for you all. But we need more education because it's real easy to know what the Christians believe in, basically. It's fairly easy to know what the Jews believe in, basically. I have no idea what the Islamic faith is about, except that they are talking in these big mega churches that you all want to kill us. Don't turn our backs on you. So I am sorry this is being said, but I'm letting you know, Professor, because Like you, I'm an attorney. I'm doing everything I can. I meet a lot of Muslim in the jails, by the way, that I go into. I work with them, okay? I'm sure you've heard this, but I thought I'd let you know this is an enlightened group. This is the best of the best. But this is not the average. Thank you.
Thank you. You know, I applaud your willingness to sit and to engage. I think that with respect to the populations that you're describing, the best approach and response is engagement and education. And I think that in response to fear, you know, if you're talking about mega churches where there are massive numbers of congregants, invite just one Muslim to come and speak. Just one. They shouldn't be too fearful of her or him because they outnumber them, right? So the likelihood of that one person, and they can, you know, go through a security check and whatnot. I know many people who would be willing to do that just for the opportunity to engage and break barriers.
I would like you all to know that the church, which is Christ Lutheran Church at the Inner Harbor near the Science Center, has a Faith in the Public Arena series, and our next speaker will be addressing exactly Islamophobia, and it's Todd Green.
Oh, wonderful.
And we've invited an imam. The pastor knows the name. He hasn't shared it with us yet, who will give his view, but we're going to have Todd Green speak, who's an expert, but he also goes to Luther College, or a professor there. But it's for Christian engagement with your Muslim neighbors. And Lutheran Immigration Refugee Service, which is next door to us, the leader is on our committee. She's on the committee with us. So she has to deal with all of these problems and about the Syrian refugees. So our church is ripe for this, and we want to open the conversation to our parishioners and neighbors.
In terms of what's useful to understand, the whole concept of the five pillars of Islam, I think that's something that's useful to set forth. And the fifth one about each year, and I may have the numbers wrong, it's not like the Christian concept of tithing 10% of your income, the concept that you will dispose of 2.5% of your wealth each year to take care of the poor. The Muslims are ahead of the Christians on that.
You know, I'm a Muslim, and having heard about this church, I just want to say that I have been invited several times into a Presbyterian church, have engaged in a lot of conversations, talked about Islam, and it has been a wonderful conversation. We continue to do that. I invited them to our home, and a large group came, and on Sunday we're invited into one of their homes. So as much as what this lady said about what may be going on in this church in Florida, I just want to say that there are many, many, many churches that are engaging in a very constructive way with Muslim American community.
And to add to that as well, you know, in addition to the speaking engagement, interfaith dialogue, there are also humanitarian efforts that are happening in the context of synagogues and churches and mosques as well. So for instance, in New York, for the past 10 years, there's been this initiative on Christmas Eve where Muslims and Jews and some Christians actually get together at an Episcopalian church in Manhattan, and they serve food to the homeless on Christmas Eve, and wish these individuals a happy holiday at a very difficult time in their life. But they do so in a spirit of interreligious harmony. So I just wanted to highlight that these sort of initiatives are also happening around the country, but we often don't hear about it.
Yeah, I just want to really just support what Engy was saying earlier in this conversation around what can Muslims do when there is entrenched, deep bigotry or racism in specific contexts, and how can we walk in and change that space. And I just do want to say that it can indeed also be physically and psychically harmful for Muslims to walk into spaces that are brimming with hate, and that this is the space for Christian and Jewish and other secular allies to step in. Even in these spaces where I think when you have spaces that are deeply entrenched in bigotry against Muslims, very likely they're also entrenched in bigotry against other types of communities. So even talking about really self-questioning, self-reflection, where does this bigotry emerge from, can only be a conversation for that community. I actually think it's really hard for a Muslim or a person who is a target of bigotry to walk in and make themselves vulnerable in that space. Maybe later, once the initial work has been done by someone like you, perhaps, or I mean, you're not part of the church, but you know people there, who educates herself around this issue and becomes an ally and stands up in solidarity. And that is the first step. And then make that space safe for a Muslim or someone else to walk in and be able to make themselves vulnerable.
You're wonderful. Would you suggest, I hear folks saying, you know, how can I dip my toe in the pond to learn more? And I went through a stage like this a couple of years ago and came up with reading Muhammad, A Prophet for Our Time by Karen Armstrong. I know it's a very basic book, but is it, would you suggest something like that to kind of give you an easy introduction?
Absolutely. I think Karen Armstrong is great. You know, and I also wanted to highlight, you know, an observation in response to what this young lady shared with us earlier about her interfaith efforts, and about, you know, there was a question about what organizations contribute to this cause that we should financially donate to. And I think what this highlights is that sometimes we try to emulate one another or compete with one another in terms of what our contribution can be. And I personally subscribe to the belief that each of us has unique talents and opportunities to contribute in a unique way to make a special impact. And so for some of us, the contribution we're going to make is largely financial. That's what we're able to do, and that's how we're going to make a difference, is through our financial contribution. Some people are really skilled writers. So they're going to be able to write op-eds, and they're going to write letters to the editors, and they're going to write to their congresswomen and men, right, to ask for change. Some people are great community organizers or enjoy interfaith dialogue, and that's where they're going to make their contribution. I think the key is that you need to be honest with yourself in terms of, and sort of do a self-assessment. What do you enjoy doing? What are you skilled at? And then I think that when you come up with the answer, you'll realize how you can make a unique contribution, whether it's in this sphere of protecting the US constitutional and guarding the First Amendment, or in other spheres as well. Right, so I just wanted to highlight that.
I happen to believe that the way you change people is not to attend lectures, but to get people to meet, like Christians to meet with Muslims individually. And Broadmead here, a retirement community, sent a bus down to the Islamic Center on Johnny Cake Road and spent a day down there. And that's when President Obama visited fairly recently. And it's that kind of interaction where you know people that changes. And there's a neighborhood in Baltimore, Windsor Hills, where I used to live before I went to retirement community. And a Muslim moved in next door to me. He had a mosque in his own home. There were two more Muslim families a couple blocks away. And people in the neighborhood got to know them, and they became the most popular people in the neighborhood. And so I think that the way to reach people is to get them to where they will meet Muslims on an individual basis, and that Islamic Center is a wonderful place. I may mention I was fortunate enough to travel extensively in Muslim countries, so I got to know a number of them, so I got over that prejudice years and years ago. But I don't think the problem is more lectures, it's more contact.
Thank you. And I think to support your point, there's research that shows that individuals who actually have personal contact with Muslims are more likely to have favorable opinions of Muslims. Again, I think the challenge is just in the numbers, just from an empirical perspective. When Muslims are just 1-2% of your population, it can be challenging for an everyday average American out in Idaho or in New Mexico to come into contact with a Muslim American, without any extra planning and organizing. And that's why the news media is so influential in terms of shaping our perceptions and our thoughts, which also speaks to the importance of having more representation of Muslims on TV and on our screens, right? In terms of when we're having these discussions about Muslims and Islam, we need to be involving the communities that we're talking about rather than talking about people without involving them. So, but thank you for your insights.
Towards the beginning of your presentation, I believe you were referring to surveillance by police departments and maybe the Northeast Corridor. Is that funded by the departments themselves, or is that extra departmental networking that's making that happen? And then secondly, is that practice trending upwards or trending downwards?
So that particular surveillance was conducted by the NYPD, the New York Police Department, and it was by a demographics unit that has since been disbanded and has also resulted in a number of lawsuits alleging violations of the US Constitution and a number of related amendments. What is the status now in terms of local law enforcement agents engaging in surveillance? That remains to be seen, particularly because on a campaign trail, our current president lauded the efforts of the NYPD's demographic unit. He thought it was a mistake that they were disbanded.
On behalf of the ICJS, I just want to thank you so much for an informative lecture and a wonderful Q&A session that I think brought an incredible amount of literacy into the room and also hopefully new relationships into the room. And then I also want to take an opportunity to synthesize a couple of the comments that we've heard in the last sort of 20 minutes. And I think that the ICJS, what we're trying to do is have both religious literacy, that knowledge piece, and the contact piece, the real relationships piece, and that you can't have one without the other and have sort of resilient interreligious networks come into being and the sort of greatest parts of the American ideals realized. And so I think you really highlighted for that for us this evening. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you to all.